Well, new jobs numbers are out, and the unemployment rate ticked down 0.1% to 9.1%. So is this a glimmer of hope, coming just days after a lousy debt deal in Washington, which avoided a near U.S. default, and where we saw stocks slide the most since 2009?
It was certainly an encouraging development that we were way above expectations.
Way above expectations, but let's see reality. 117,000 jobs were added last month. But how many does the U.S. need to just account for new people coming into the workforce, not even those that lost their jobs? 125,000. Wah, wah, doesn't make the cut. Also, the unemployment rate went down because more people left the workforce, so weren't counted in this rate. And why are they out of the workforce? Maybe because it's so hard to get a job. The average duration of unemployment rose to a new record of close to 10 months. And the share of the eligible population holding a job, so just working age people, declined to 58%, which is the lowest since 1983 in July. Okay, so, well, that doesn't sound great, but at least the default is behind us. Washington has reassured the world it can pay its debts. Let's look at some of those global reactions, though. What are countries joking about? Well, in the United Kingdom, they have Obama surfing the debt crisis wave while Europe crumbles into it. That, of course, Angela Merkel and Sarkozy waiting to crumble into the U.S. debt crisis. Not a good outlook, I wouldn't say. Who else? What comes from another country? This one is from Brazil. You have Uncle Sam saying, let's see what the fortune cookie says today. You better pay. Who do they better pay? China, waiting for that fortune, who holds more than $1 trillion in U.S. debt, making up a large portion of the $4.5 trillion that foreigners hold in U.S. debt. So they seem to have a little more realistic take than those in Washington. Now, here is my favorite. This one comes from The Economist out of England, and it has the Tea Party dragging Uncle Sam, dragging the world, and the world saying, something is definitely wrong here. So anyone who thinks that the United States has avoided a catastrophe, I think that those cartoons coming from all over the world show the impact that it's had beyond the Beltway. Now, on top of this, there's more talk of quantitative easing for a third round. People have different feelings about that. Markets are volatile today after the Dow's 500-point plunge yesterday, and the dollar hit a record low earlier this week. All of this bad news. What can anyone do? We'll get to what some people are doing later, but first, Richard Wolff, economist and talk show host of WBAI Radio, is here with his solutions. Thanks for being here. Now, can these issues, I just named a number of them, joblessness, the debt, all of these, can they be fixed, or do they point to something that you have spoken about with me before, that the system is broken?
I think these are chickens coming home to roost in that stock market plunge yesterday. We've had 20 years of being told that a private enterprise economy is the royal road to success and prosperity forever. Then we had a crash of that system. Now we've had a recovery by a government that took care of the banks and insurance companies first and assured us it would trickle down. It's not trickling down. That's what these unemployment numbers mean. That's what the increasing foreclosure of people being thrown out of their homes means, and so on. The stock market is finally, the investment community itself, realizing that this system is broken and that there is nothing on the horizon to take it out. And the anxiety that used to be among all the average people, the vanishing middle class, and all the people worried about government spending, that anxiety is now spreading even to the top of the economy as they realize they've gone way too far and may have killed the goose that is laying the golden egg, at least for them.
So then are you saying that capitalism is a problem?
I think it's a system that's in serious trouble. And because we refuse here in the United States to have the debate we should have had for 50 years, namely to assess that system, to ask the question honestly, is it capitalism working for us? Can we do better? We were afraid to, like pretending that those awful unemployment numbers that were released today are good news when they show that the unemployment problem will get worse, not better.
So why do you think
people... I think it's long overdue.
So why do you think it is that for decades, as you say, people don't want to ask the question, is capitalism the problem in America?
Well, for a long... For a long time, it was the Cold War. It was a question that was taboo, like discussing sex in the wrong situation with the wrong people. But we can't afford that anymore. This system isn't working. The solutions are not really solutions. The problems keep getting worse. The world as a whole looks to the United States and is not happy with what it sees. It is long overdue, and if we don't discuss it, it certainly isn't going to go away by itself.
So you say this is a taboo that remains from the Cold War, probably, I guess you're alluding to any kind of discussion of socialism or communism or moving away from capitalism. But yet in Europe, which was affected by the Cold War as well, they have socialist parties, they have social democracies. So what do you make of that?
Well, I think that the Europeans did not... Yeah, the Europeans over the last 30 and 40 years did not have the experience of a collapsing labor movement. They did not have the experience of a disappearing socialist, communist, and other anti-capitalist movements. So they've had present in their society strong movements involving many, 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 many people demanding services and support, not allowing their societies to go in the direction of gross inequality like here. You know, in our own history as a country, back in the 1930s, the last time we had this economic problem, it was the trade union movement, the socialist, the communist parties who forced Franklin Roosevelt to react, for example, by creating and filling 11 million federal jobs in the 1930s because the private sector wasn't doing it. That kind of courage, pushed from below, still is active in Europe relative to what we have here, and that's why it's so painful here and why the rest of the world worries about the deterioration that continues to plague the U.S. economy.
But what is there to replace capitalism in the United States? Because clearly some of the social democracies in Europe aren't working out too well. They're crumbling as we speak.
Yes, there have been problems in that arrangement too. No one is arguing that there's a magic bullet, a perfect system that's to replace it. They have to struggle with the inadequacies in their system in Europe, just as we do here. But you begin with all these kinds of problems by facing the reality that when the system isn't working for the bulk of the people, like in this country, a recovery that the masses still are waiting to experience, then it's time to ask and find ways of doing better, picking the best and avoiding the worst of other systems. That's what a healthy society, willing to interrogate its own institutions, could and should do, and we're long overdue for it here in the United States.
But do you think that, you know, you're sitting in New York, you do this for a living, this is your life's work, you ask these questions, do you think you can ever get, you know, Larry in Arkansas to question capitalism and want to look at some of the socialist ideas? I mean, how do you get that to happen? Is that reality?
Well, at this point in the United States, we're at an earlier stage. The magic, the glow, the blush, whatever you want to call it, of a strutting capitalism convinced it had won the great struggle with alternative systems and could deliver the goods. It's not delivering the goods, it's delivering the bads. That's why people are beginning to ask difficult questions, join more extreme movements, some of which we don't like. But the point is, we're opening the space with the deterioration of the system's functioning, mm-hmm. the space for alternatives, Larry in Arkansas and Mary in Wyoming, they are beginning to be receptive to ideas of change. And I think those are coming, and there will be those in America who are afraid of it, but I think the majority will see we need to do it for the benefit of a society whose directions otherwise are scary to contemplate.
But a lot of the people that we've seen take to the streets that are, you know, Larry in Arkansas or whatever, that have taken to Tea Party rallies are holding up signs saying that, you know, Obama has moved towards socialism. So I don't know if I'm convinced on that point, but I want to ask you, you talked about delivering the goods, so deliver me the goods. What would you do? Who do you squeeze? Who do you, how do you replace capitalism? Who do you tax? Who do you, you know, what do you do?
Well, I think the first step in that direction is to say, once upon a time in the 1940s, 50s, and 60s, the United States felt it had to recover from a Great Depression and a horrible World War II. And in those years, we decided to do that by taxing corporations and taxing the rich. And we did that. The top income tax bracket, 91%. for the richest Americans in those years. Corporations paying more to the federal government than individuals do, although now it's all been reversed. The first thing we have to do is go back, recognize we're in a national crisis again, because capitalism didn't work again, as it didn't in the 30s, and begin to take dramatic steps along the lines that Franklin Roosevelt was forced to do in the 1930s.
So do you squeeze the rich, tax the rich more? Is that one of the solutions? To redistribute wealth?
Well, we've come after 30 years now of a class war that took wealth away from the poor and the middle and reallocated it to the rich. Now's the time to go back, because that wasn't successful. That brought us to the mess we're in now and needs to be reversed to get us out. But once we're out of the immediate mess, we have to ask a basic question, which I think the American people are ready to hear. And that is, if we believe in democracy, it has to include where we work. No more the mass of people come in the morning, Monday to Friday, 9 to 5, do their work, produce the output, and go home. And a tiny group of people, a board of directors, major shareholders, make all the decisions, what to produce, how to produce, where to produce, and what to do with the profits. That's gotten us into trouble. We have to have the democracy that we believe in operate at the workplace so that the people as a whole can decide how, where, when to work and what to do with the profits. That will reallocate the way this economy works. Just as an example, people who made that decision, would they move the factory out of the United States to someplace else and deprive themselves of a job? I don't think so.
What about
would they take steps to
What about things like taxing luxuries, higher taxes for gas? You see gas tax at a much higher rate in Europe.
Yes, you can do all those things, but they are all playing at the edges. They're not dealing with the basics. We're in too bad a situation to go back to marginal adjustments. We got to deal with the roots of our problem, because we're having a crisis of our basic system, and because we haven't dealt with those roots for 30 years while we made believe to ourselves that this system was going to work forever and didn't need any tweaking. We now have to go and make up for the lost time, because we're running out of time, and I think the American people feel it, that the interest in the Tea Party is less a support of their arguments than a plea, a cry, that something big has to change and that conventional politics are inadequate.
Real quickly.
That's the point the Tea Party people make.
Really quickly, yes or no, big changes, fundamental changes, big, huge conversations. With the way things work in Washington and have been working lately, and just in our country, is that possible, really, in reality? Do you think that's going to happen?
Yes, but it's not going to happen in the existing old institutions of the Republican and Democratic Party. You will see new political initiatives, as the Tea Party in a small way is, but there'll be some coming from the left, and they will either rewrite the history of these old political parties, or they will have new and different parties. As the Europeans have had, and have had very well, we will learn also from their experiences and begin to reshape the political life of America to deal with these problems, because the existing parties have not done that successfully.
And we'll see if that happens, and we'll see if they can get on the ballots even. This is a two-party system that has a lot of limitations that way, but I appreciate you for coming on and talking about that. That was Richard Wolff, economist and talk show host of WBAI Radio. Now,